to another lecture and let us start this lecture. So in the last class, we talked about two-fourths members and three-fourths members, and we will see that these are very important and handy in doing analysis of structures. So we also did an introduction in the last class. Now the idea is that we want to calculate forces in the structures, right? So not just the reactions, but using the reactions, we also want to calculate inside these structures. Now we have had some introductory examples of bridges where you can see that they carry very huge amount of load, and it's very nicely designed. There was also a very good question, and hopefully we'll answer that some more. Okay, so then structures, we said that there are three types of structures: truss, frames, and machines. So truss is defined as it is made up of only two-fourths members. Frames are defined as if you have three-fourths member or multiple members, then it is called as a frame. And machines are structures, but they can move, they have moving parts, and they can transmit and modify forces. Now again, this is the definition given in your books, but sometimes machines are categorized as different from structures. There is again some gray region where some books define it one way, some other books define it other way. Okay, so these are some examples that we see, and now in this class we are going to do a more detailed analysis on truss. Right, so we are going to learn some methods to analyze truss. Now this is again a beautiful picture of a bridge made up of truss. So truss is defined primarily by if the members are only two-fourths members, then that is called as a truss. So in this figure you can see that these are A, B, C, D as a truss, and each of the member is a two-fourths member only, right? And that is one point. The another point is that the loads, they act only at joints, right? So if this load were to act somewhere in the middle or at some other point, then obviously it is not going to be a two-fourths member. So the requirement of two-fourths member ensures that forces act only at joints or nodes, and so our truss consists of straight members connected at joints. No member is continuous through a joint, right? So so you won't find a three-fourths member or four-fourths member, and ideally speaking two-fourths member can have any shape, but generally in trusses you will see straight members only, right? So theoretically speaking you can have all kinds of curves possible, but for most of the cases, you will find straight members. In some cases, we will also see that there are curved members as well, but generally it is straight. Now, here is a kind of a catch or an important assumption. So in most of the trusses, bridges, you will find that the members are either tightly bolted together, so there is a nut and bolt arrangement, or they are welded together, or sometimes you may even find riveted joints. So ideally speaking, these joints, they will also transmit moments, right? Because if it is a rigid joint, if they are connected together, pin joint does not offer a moment, but a welded joint or riveted or bolted joint, they do offer a moment. So there can be reaction forces as well as moments. But now this assumption, it is assumed that these are almost similar to as the pin joint here, right? So there is an assumption here and we must be aware of it. However, if we test it either experimentally or numerically, I definitely have done this testing. And we have found that whether it is welded or it is just pin joint, the results don't change much. So this thing, computationally, I have last semester we were doing a course and we did this testing, and yeah, it worked out in that way. So this assumption is quite valid. And the members, okay, so if it, the mem if everything is a two-force member, then the members are in tension or in compression, right? So if you pick up any member, it is going to be either in tension or in compression, right? Okay. Now this is another picture of connections in a truss. Now coming to a more bigger picture, like let's say a bridge, something like what you can see here. Now you can see that these are made up of several trusses. So this bridges, the name that is given is space framework. We are not going to go into details of it, but this is just an introduction. So if you have a bridge, something like this, you can see that these members, right? You can see my cursor. So this is a truss, and this member can take only vertical load, right? Well, not just vertical, but only in this plane. So a truss can take only planar loads in that plane. And to use their loading property, there is another thing that are used are these floor beams and stringers. So this is horizontal thing is your floor beam, and these are your stringers. So suppose if you have a road or a railway track going through this, the load of this track has to be distributed on this truss. And that distribution of that load, so this red color you can see is the load of the road or railway track. So this load is distributed on this truss by the means of beams and stringers. So these are beams which are, you can see like this, and stringers are along the length of the bridge. And these two members, they distribute the load, which is the, the main load, a red color load on the trusses. And this ultimately will act on here, right? So this will act here, this will act here, and these loads once this comes, then it will, you will see that this will be transmitted to all these members, and that's how all these members carry these loads, that's how the engineering design works. Now again, more details on that, I think civil engineers will study in their advanced courses. Even more than that, I also don't know. So I think that's all from space framework. Okay. Now, but of course, what we are going to learn is how do we analyze these planar trusses, right? So these things we will learn in this lecture as well as maybe in the next lecture. Now, some more applications truss. So before we go to some calculations, let's see some more applications. So bridges we have already seen, but another important applications are roof structures. So if you go to any industries, workshops, factories and so on, you will find these kinds of structures. The advantage is it is very cost effective. They are very rugged. They have very long life. And they have a lot of advantage, and you get a lot of space, right? Imagine if you have to construct this much big shed out of concrete or some other thing. These things are much more beneficial. Okay. Now here are some other examples. Like some of you have asked me how is the campus and how it looks like. So I thought I'll just share with you a pic of the campus. So this is something from my office. You can see this is the view. So of course what I wanted to share you is towers, right? So another example of truss are towers, which we can see even from everywhere we'll see these towers, and even here from my office you can see these transmission line towers and telephone towers and so on. Okay. This is another pic of again from my office. Anyone would like to comment any other kind of truss if you can identify in this picture? Anyone would like to quickly speak out? Any other place where you can see truss in this pic? I'm not able to hear.
So in this cloth drying stand.
Okay, where is clothes drying stand? Oh, here. Okay, that's interesting. So yeah, these are your hostels, and yeah, I think this is what somebody. So there is a cloth drying stand for the boys' hostel. This is yeah, this is some swings arranged for students, and okay, good. Any other?
The roofs.
So, yeah.
So the structures to hold the electricity cables, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. So these, this one you're talking about?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah, yeah, of course. So these are the towers, the transmission line towers. These are made up of trusses. That's correct. Okay. Even your hostel roofs. So inside these structures, there are trusses, right? So these were built in front of us only. So. So there are truss structures inside your this thing. So anyway, don't worry. I hope all of you will come sometime and you'll be able to enjoy this place. Okay. Okay. Something more, applications of truss. So stadiums, right? So I'm sure you will be able to recall this one, what this stadium is. But yeah, so all these stadiums, again, you can see now here, you can see that there are curved members as well, right? So this is the example I was talking about, that sometimes there can be curved members, but mostly it is straight. So now these were some of the examples, and if we summarize them, or I would say engineers have summarized them in some special kinds of trusses, and there are some special names associated, I think, with the inventors of these designs. So for roof structure, there are three designs, which are Pratt, Howe, and Fink. And you know, these are the designs by this thing. For bridges, you know, these are some of the common designs. You have K, Truss, Baltimore, Warren, Howe, Pratt. And similarly, you can see stadium. You should be able to see that if we kind of revolve this design or extrude this in a particular direction, you will be able to get this kind of stadium truss design, right? So this is again made up of truss. This is cantilever. So if you want to have an overhanging bridge or something, you know, just for this bicycle, I don't know. Okay, so these are again, you know, just some common prominent designs. Now let's come to some definitions on truss. So there are some simple definitions which we must be aware of. So the first definition is called as a rigid truss. So rigid truss, as the name suggests, is that it will not collapse under the application of a load. So for example, the figure B, if you can see here, this is a rigid truss. This will, the loads are applied at A, B, and C, and this is not going to move. This is going to be as it is, right? Under the rigid body assumption. So of course, if the members are, you know, real structures, there is elasticity, then there will be some deformations. But as far as our assumption in this course of rigid bodies are concerned, this is will not move. But if you consider figure A, and if I consider truss A, B, C, D, right? So it's a quadrilateral, and it is also made up of two force members only. But here you can see that if I apply load at, you know, A and D are fixed, or, you know, there is a reactions at A and D. And if I apply a force at point B, point B can move freely, right? So point B can move, point C can move to C prime, point B can move to B prime, and your structure can move, and it will come to a green configuration, something like this. So this is not called as a structure. In fact, for mechanical engineering, there is a full course on this, and these are called as mechanisms. how things move and how can they move, right? So this is not a structure. I mean, this is not a rigid structure or a rigid truss. This is a rigid truss. Yeah, so B is a rigid truss, A is not a rigid truss. And now the next definition is called as a simple truss. So I would say, I mean, B truss, what you can see is called as a simplest truss. So this is the kind of simplest possible truss. And any truss built up on this simple truss is called as a simple truss, right? So a simple truss is constructed by successfully adding two members and one connection to the basic triangular truss. So if you have a basic triangular truss and if you keep on adding two members and one point, then that will lead to a simple truss. For example, so here is your ABC, right? Now on this ABC, now if I add another point here and two members, so if I add this thing and this thing, then this is also a simple truss. Then if I add another point here and if I join here, something like this, then this is also called as a simple truss. If I add something like this, this is again a simple truss. So and here I can add this and two members like this. This is also simple truss. So therefore, you can see the idea or the definition of a simple truss is that by successfully adding two members and one connection or one joint to a basic triangular truss. So we start with the triangular truss and then we keep on adding. Then by this, whatever truss you get is also called as a simple truss. Now here you can see that this, you know, figure D and even this figure is, these are simple trusses. They are made up with one triangle and then keep on adding. Now a simple truss need not be rigid. So that is, we start with a rigid simple truss, but here you can see that things can move, right? So it is not necessary that simple truss is going to be rigid. Okay, so with this basic definition, let's go to some calculations, which is what this chapter is about. And so as I said in the beginning, we want to calculate the forces in the members of a complicated truss. It may be a bridge truss, it may be a roof, it may be a stadium, whatever design it may be. So for this, there are a couple of methods, and in this class we will look at method of joints. So what this method says, first of all, draw the free body diagram for the entire truss and solve for the three support reactions. Now this is again for only for a 2D case, right? So for 2D case, you can solve for three support reactions. And so suppose this truss is given to us, and let us say this is the problem, which is having pin support at A and roller support at end B. So for roller support, we will have only vertical load. For pin support, we will have Rx and Ry, so which is at an angle, and we don't know the angle, we don't know the magnitude. P is the external load, which is due to some bridge or whatever. So it is an external load applied downward at the joint. Now the question is, we want to calculate forces in all the members of the truss. So first step is to draw the free body diagram for the entire system and calculate the reactions, right? So reactions you can calculate. For example, if I balance moment about point A, you can say that P times AD should be equal to RB times AB. From there, you can calculate what is your RB. Similarly, you can balance force, balance moment about point B. You can calculate RA, right? So this is the first step, which we have seen in the previous chapter, and you should be able to do that. After that, the next step is create the free body diagram for each member and each pin. So we have to dismantle each member and each pin separately and draw the free body diagram, as you can see in this figure. So for example, here member AC is assumed to be in compression, and therefore, by Newton's third law, if this force is acting downward, then on this joint C, this force is in opposite direction. Similarly, this member CD is assumed to be in tension, and therefore the corresponding forces are applied at node C, and similarly here. Okay. Now, next is we have to find a starting point. So after we have drawn the free body diagram, we have to apply the equilibrium equation for two unknown forces at each pin or joint. So then we have to, I would say, intelligently select which node or which joint to use, which joint or pin to use, and apply the equilibrium equations. And by applying equilibrium equations, we can, for example, at point A, once RA is known, now there are only two forces. One is this force, and another is this force. So we can solve for these forces at this node. And once these forces are known, we can solve for forces at other nodes, and we can sequentially move throughout the structure, right? So forces are found by solving for unknown forces while moving from joint to joint sequentially. So first we will solve for one joint, then we will move to another joint, then to third joint, then to, as long as the truss is covered, right? So that is why it is called as method of joint. So we will keep on moving from one joint to other joint to other joint, and that's the method. Don't worry, we will see some examples and we will try to understand it better, right? So this is just a summary. Okay, so here is an example. So let's understand it in a better way. So this is an example of a power transmission line, what you have seen on the mountains just outside my office. The dimensions may be different, but yeah, this is a typical dimension of transmission power. And let us solve this example. Okay, I hope you can see my white screen. Can you see the one note?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So here is an example of a truss, and you can see the loads shown by red color, and we have to calculate the forces in the members. Now, this is a happened to be a special a special case where we can directly start with certain node and we will be able to solve it, right? So in this particular example, we don't have to calculate the reactions, and the reason I will explain it soon why. Okay, so let us consider node A, right? So if I consider this as node A, and let us say here it is acted by, this is 1.2 kilonewton that is given to us, and let me assume that this node is being pulled like this, right? So I'm calling this as FAB, and this is FAC. This is joint A. So this is what we are drawing the free body diagram. So if this is the assumption that I am starting with, then if I draw the free body diagram for link AB, then I can say that this force is going to be equal and opposite, right? So this force will act by equal and opposite, something like this, FAB. And similarly, since this is a two force member, force at B has to be equal and opposite, so it has to be something like this, FAB. Similarly, I can draw AC. And this FAC, this is the assumption that I have made. This will appear equal and opposite by Newton's third law. So this is FAC. And again, this AC is a two-force member. And this whole tower is in static equilibrium. So therefore, this is equal and opposite FAC along same line. Okay. Excuse so me, this sir. Is the... Yes?
Sir, how you are able to decide that which rod is in compression or in elongation?
It's just... it's my choice. I have assumed it. If it is opposite, the numerical value will turn out to be negative. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the free body diagram of the members AB, AC, and the pin or joint A that I have drawn. Okay. Now, all these things are in static equilibrium. That is what it is said. So for AB and AC, we have already applied the two force member condition. Now we will say that this joint A is in static equilibrium. And if this is in static equilibrium, so we can say that summation of all forces should be equal to zero because it is a node. So for a node, we can say summation of forces should be equal to zero. So I can say sigma fx is equal to zero, sigma fy is equal to zero. So now here we have two equations for force balance. And we can see that there are only two variables, FAB and FAC. Now, a very important thing to note, forces are vectors, so they have magnitude and direction. So if I write F vector AB, it has two things. So it has got magnitude and it has got direction. But due to this truss two force member, I know the direction of FAB. So the direction is known, magnitude is not known. So therefore, this effectively is one variable. If the direction was not known, then this was two variable or two scalar variable. But now I have direction is known, magnitude is not known. So it is one variable here. So I have only two variables and this problem can be solved. So now let us solve this problem. There are a couple of ways you can solve this problem. So of course we need these angles, right? So from this geometry, you can see that this is, right? So this is 0.6 and this is 2.21. So if I take the tan inverse of this angle, this comes out to be around 15.19 degrees, right? So this angle is tan inverse of 0.6 by 2.21, which is around 15.19 degrees. So this angle is 15.19. Similarly, this angle is also 15.19. And if this angle is 15.19, then this angle is 74.8. And if you want to solve in this diagram itself, we can draw this angle. And this angle, you can see it is 180 plus 74 degrees. So this is around 254.8 degrees, right? So if you want to just solve it in this diagram itself, we can directly write the sine law. Let me copy this. Okay. So now in this triangle, the three forces are in equilibrium. So I can directly say, so from this, we can say that this force divided by its opposite angle. So I can say that 1.2 kilonewtons divided by sine of this becomes 30.38 is equal to FAB and its opposite angle is 74.8. Sine of 74.8 is equal to FAC divided by its opposite angle is 254.8. sine of 254.8 degrees. So just by this one equation, now you can do simple calculations and you will see that your FAB is 2.289 kilonewtons and FAC is equal to minus of 2.289 kilonewtons. So now here you can see FAC has come up negative. So in other words, if I redraw this diagram with in a better way, this is 1.2. Now this, instead of pulling in this direction, it is going inside. So I can, you know, draw it something like this. And if AB is something like this. This is around 15 degrees. This is also around 15 degrees. And yeah, that's it. So now this is again a different diagram. So this one was for this with a negative sign. Now here it is positive. Right. So you can draw diagram either this way, you can draw diagram like this way, you can take components and solve it, but ultimately what you have to do is you have to do this equation for a node. How you do it, it is up to you, whatever way you feel convenient. So now we have calculated forces in members AB and AC. And it is also good to note it down. So now if these are the forces at node A, then this one was AB. So now if AB is acting at node A in this direction, then for member AB, it is going to act equal and opposite, something like this. And therefore it is a two force member, so it will be something like this. Similarly, member AC, this force on node A is acting in this direction, so on this, for member AC, it will be acting something like this, and therefore this will be in compression. So therefore now we can say that AB is in tension and AC is in compression. And how much is the force? So the force is 2.289 or 2.9 kilonewtons and 2.29 kilonewtons, right? So this is the way we assume forces and solve for forces in member A, AB and AC. Now, can we solve for node, or can we solve for joint B? So if I draw the free body diagram for joint B, right? So we have found that AB is in tension. So if AB is being pulled, then node B will be pulled like this. So if I draw it for node B, this is being pulled like this. Force in member BD, we do not know. Force in member BE, we do not know. Force in member BC, that also we do not know, right? But we know the directions of these three forces because these are all two force members. BD, BE, BC are all two force members. So we know the directions, but we don't know the magnitude. And therefore we have one variable, two variable, three variable. So three variables, one node, we cannot solve, because for one node, force balance will give us two equations. We have three nodes, we cannot solve. So no point in going to point B. It's like a puzzle, right? So point B does not work out. So now what do you think? Any other point can we work out? So just like ABC, we can use the same logic for FDE. So FDE, it's exactly same scenario. So you will solve it, you will get the same situation. We will find that DF is in tension, just like AB. AB was in tension, yes. So AB was in tension. Similarly, DF will be in tension. So this is maybe I'll draw, copy the figure. I think today I'm exceeding the time, I hope, but we'll try to finish it quickly. So member, yeah, this was in tension. This was in compression. And you'll see the same free body diagram. What comes for point A comes same thing for joint F. So this is 2.29 kilonewton of force. Now, if I draw for node D, then if this is in tension, then this force here will be thing like this, which is F DF. And this is known, right? So this is 2.29 kilonewton. Force DE, we don't know the magnitude, but we know the direction. It will be something like this. Force DB is, again, we don't know magnitude, but we know the direction. It will be something like this. So let us draw it some F DB and F DE. So now here you can see we have two unknowns, FDB and FDE, and one node, two unknowns. By static equilibrium, force balance, it can be solved, and it is very easy. You can see here, this is 15 degrees, 15 point something. so you can directly say that FDF or 2.29 sine of 15 degrees, this will be equal to FDE. So in fact, this will turn out to be of opposite direction, right? So this is going downward, so this has to be upward. And from there, you can calculate this thing. And similarly, FD, this force cosine 15 degree is equal to this thing. So from here, you can calculate this thing, right? So these are calculated. Once node D is calculated, now we can go to node B. So now we can go to node B, and at node B, now we know that this is FAB. This is known completely. Now, this FDB will be known. FDB. This is known after solving joint D. We know this. This is known. Now, two things that are unknown is this FBC and FBE. So, these are two unknowns we do not know. Directions we know, magnitude we do not know, and again by applying equilibrium at this node, you will be able to solve this at node B. Now, once this node B is known, FBC will be known, and FBC is known, AC is known. Now we can use node C to calculate CH and CE, and this way you can propagate, and you can, you know, that's the method of joints that. So I think that's all for this lecture. So I'll stop this recording and